Welcome back. If the word hot can be ascribed to a gospel artist, that artist is Kevin Downswell. Today I rise. Born in Westmoreland, Jamaica, and raised across four parishes on the island. As a young man, Downswell had great hopes of becoming a medical doctor and was well on his way to achieving that objective when he found his true calling. Mighty awakening. The year was 2003, and young Kevin, a student at the University of the West Indies, enrolled in a biochemistry degree program. Kevin entered and won JCDC's annual gospel song competition that year, and soon after emerged a recording artist. In 2005, just 2 years later, not only was Downswell an accomplished artist in the gospel arena, he was also an ordained evangelist. And though he was able to finish the degree in biochemistry that same year, all hopes of becoming a doctor sunk.
Back to Jamaica.
Downswell became a full-fledged music ministry who is now the hottest name in gospel and is our very special guest right now, right here on our stage.
Thank you for
Kevin,
having me.
Sir.
Hot.
Oh, yes. If there's a word in my view, I'm the one saying this, not you. You're
Thank
not
you.
Saying it, but I'm saying it. Okay? I'm saying, sir, that in the last four years? I think it's about 4 years. There is no question about who's gospel's leading man from where I sit.
Well, the important thing is for me, mm-hmm. that's not the focus.
Okay.
My focus is way beyond just being the head or the lead or number one or number two. My focus is purpose.
Clearly.
And so if purpose gets you to a place where people celebrate you like that, then it's not mine to embrace it, but mine to just say I'm grateful.
Because you have the attention.
Yeah, I'm to God be all the glory.
Yeah, because that's the first step, you know, to get the people's attention, which you do have. All right, so take us back to 2003, okay? When you emerged a recording artist.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You were an artist before, you were in music
before.
What changed? What was the single biggest reason why you decided now, I have found my calling?
Well, Taste the Talent Contest used to happen before that. So I did about three where I came up, the best place that I've ever placed in Tasty is third.
Yes.
That was how tough Taste the Talent competition was.
Okay.
Tasty's focus was connecting with your audience.
Mm-hmm.
Tasty was, that's what they were all about. Digging in, there's this gap between you and your audience, find a way to connect with them.
Oh, that moment on stage, that live moment.
Yes.
Yes.
So when I got to JCDC Gospel Festival in 2003,
mm-hmm.
performance was natural because over the years, I grew to become a natural performer. But what they stressed was connecting with audience.
Mm-hmm.
Don't lose your audience. Find a way to engage that audience for that 3.5 minutes that you have on stage. Don't let them blink 1 sec.
Mm-hmm.
So JCDC gave me a platform and a stage. It was a massive stage. All of Jamaica were singing the songs, the top 10 songs.
Okay.
And let me big up my uncle, Lubert Levy, because I was focused on school. I wasn't interested in entering no competition. My focus was just medicine, school.
Right,
school,
then
school.
You were enrolled in the degree program.
Biochemistry.
Mm-hmm.
And so he said, why don't us enter the festival? And I'm like, I don't have the time. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, try it, man. And I said, okay, let me try. And the rest is history.
Okay.
I mean, I won the top prize. I was shocked. To be honest, I was shocked. It was a massive moment for me.
So the win was what you would say is the biggest reason why you now say, this is what I want to do?
Well,
or was there a spiritual awakening as well?
The spiritual awakening is the best part of it. Because when I won, I really wanted to go back to studying.
Mm-hmm.
I really had no intention to continue. I was encouraged to enter. I entered and I saw what was happening, but my real focus was finishing school. Finish school first. But while I was in school and I finished up biochemistry now, here we go. My real focus was medicine. And so I applied for medicine, got through, start celebrating, I went for it. Start jumping, call my good friend who is now my wife.
Oh, she was your good friend at the time.
Called her and said, "Hey, I got you." And she's like, "Oh man," she's screaming. And I say, "I'm gonna get books now and everything." And by the time September, August, September, a first revelation came.
Okay.
Totally. It's like this is me now in prayer talking to the Lord, and all of a sudden you just felt this thing come over you. Medicine is not for you. I rebuked the voice. I said, "This is not God. This is not God. This is not God." And so weeks after that, the voice came back. "Medicine is not for you. You're called to do what I'm doing now." And I'm like, "No, this is not about it. No. I thought, and I said, "Boy, I was born for this. I was born to be a medical doctor. I was born to this." But not realizing that was here, not here.
Okay.
Medicine was what people told me that that's the best degree, that's the best thing, that brings you the most money. But my heart was way beyond that. I had to surrender. To be honest, for about 3-4 weeks, my ball went for that ball. I say, "How could you do this to me, God?" Come years after years, me I study and I focus after this, and then you come change my path like this. "How could you do this to me?" Go on stage, because I would still have events. Go on stage, minister to people, come off a stage and say, "God, why would you do this to me?" And God just said to me, "If you trust me, I'll blow your mind."
And the scientist in you was removed. No longer.
Let's put it like this. Yeah. When you serve an all-knowing God who knows all things, and you in your limited knowledge, trying to hold on to something that's not really yours, that you feel is yours, sometimes the best thing to do is just let go. And looking back now, at 2004, 5, 6, 7, at those decisive years, I'm saying to myself, why did I give God that fight? I'm looking back and I'm saying, wow.
So, okay, so it's 2003, up to 7, 8, 9.
Yeah.
You were still progressing, right?
Yes.
In gospel.
Yes.
But your prominence the prominence you're now enjoying, mm-hmm. came when?
2008, we launched the first album, Close to You. The song Close to You became like an anthem, mm-hmm. In Jamaica and the Caribbean.
Okay.
And you would travel to places like Canada, US, and people would just sing the song in their praise and worship, mm-hmm. session in church. And you're like, wow. 2012, now we launched the second album, Search Continues, and You Make Me Stronger. Mm-hmm. If it's not you, then Lord, it's already done. Those songs were on it. And the songs, the album just went like this, bam. Africa, Germany, you get messages from everywhere. And we're like, this is without intentional promotion.
Yes.
This without having a label on board.
Just a song out there floating.
Just a song.
Binding.
Put on YouTube. You'd get calls from Africa, Germany, Russia, sir, wherever. People saying, "Bro, your song is changing this place. Where you get this song from?" I'm like, and it takes me back to where I wrote the song. I wrote the song when I was going through some hell. And I didn't have an express valve. I didn't have nobody to talk to. And I just went in the living room, grabbed a pen and a paper and said, "Boy, Father God, I don't know what I'm going on. I don't know what you're doing, but my trust in me, I just declare that right here, sir, you're my creator. You know my times. My seasons of breakthrough, my seasons of trials. So I will seek you, and you all would find." I didn't write the song to become popular. I didn't write the song for it to be popular. It was just a song that came from the heart, saying to God, "I don't know what I do, but I feel so in the middle of this, in the middle of what I go on, you're making me stronger.
The whole world is out to it."
Boom. Yeah. And so 2012 was the real, was where it went boom. The four walls of the box just blow up, fire catch it, everything mash up. Mm-hmm. The limits were completely taken off. In the midst of all of that, the Lord was also teaching me to stay humble, because with all the cars getting, all the shows and all the travel, You're not reaching over yet. You're just a break the surface. So try not to pop your color. Try not to absorb the praise for yourself.
Humility.
Remember who started this, and remember who's going to take you beyond this.
All right, so you, the music got the attention of not just Jamaicans, but people all over the world. What keep them, though? When they get to know you, when they come to your concert, mm-hmm. what's keeping them? Is it the music still? They continue to feed them with music? Or is there something, is it your ministry, as you would call it in Christendom?
One of my mentors said to me, Kevin is a minister who sings,
yes.
not a singer who ministers.
Oh.
And I've never forgotten that.
So you embrace that? You believe that is the...
Yes, Mike. When I'm on a stage and I grab a mic, my first focus is, you see those eyes looking back at me? I want to make sure that you leave knowing, being encouraged, being inspired, knowing who God is. I don't want you to leave out of the building that we're in or wherever you are at, same way that mm-hmm. you came in. So my focus is always to reach the heart. That was always my focus. Because there's somebody over there on that side of the audience who might be thinking, yo, I want to give up now. There may be a husband who might be saying, boy, I can't deal with this marriage no more. One word from my mouth could change all of that. Mm-hmm. You'll never hear me sing a song for just wave your hand. Let me see you move your body for Jesus. No. Because the bottom line of what I'm saying is exactly what God wants me to say and what God wants me to speak in your life for you to realize that all of this, he can take you through it and bring it over. I don't believe that we should have make it our goal to be better than anybody or to compare ourselves. I believe it comes as a part of what God has done. Mm-hmm. But the focus should be what's ahead. The focus should be what God plays inside our heart, and we're going after that no matter what. Blindfolds on. And because at the end of the day, just like somebody could say you're good at this, somebody could say you're terrible at this. Mm-hmm. Just like somebody could praise you today, them could rebuke you tomorrow. And so it's important for us to know that when Paul said, I do this, I don't do this for the applause of men. I do this for the glory of God. It's important for us, especially gospel artists, to remind ourselves that the applause is good, you know. The screams are awesome, but don't forget that the glory goes to God.
You must be winning young souls,
yes.
aren't you? You're winning souls.
Oh my gosh.
Lots of young souls.
It's humbling. It's amazing to see kids, Winford, kids, 2, 3, 4 year old. Even mummies would leave messages on Facebook saying, my baby, I'm in my second trimester, and when I play your music, my baby dancing on my belly. My baby just born, and she's 6 months old. And when she cry, once I put on your music, it's amazing. Then you go to the teenagers, and you realize their response to your music. You visit the schools, and you see them in the audience, and once you go on stage and you go, 24 hours a day, the response. Mm-hmm. I'm grateful, but I realize that it's a responsibility. It's important for me to not just be carried away with the fact that I have such a great following, but it's important for me to be level-headed and to know that these guys need direction. And it's important for me to know that when I go on a stage like this, they're listening, they're watching, and they're using my life too. Believe it or not, as much as we as artists, secular and gospel, disown the fact that we are somewhat fathers to some of these guys mm-hmm. and mentors.
You don't disown it. You have a responsibility.
I embrace it. I mean, mother and daddy will do their part, guardians will do their part. But if they listen to us so much every day with their earbuds in their ears, mm-hmm. 24 hours a day, sometimes fall asleep.
You must be influencing them.
So it's important for us for me to know that in as much as they love me, care for what me I say, mm-hmm. lead them in the right direction. I can't say everything what me want to say all the time. Mm-hmm. I have to listen what God wants me to say, because I don't know exactly what them I got you, but he knows. So when he inspire me and say, Kevin, I want you to write this song, I don't want you to say this. Nobody loves me the way you do. And release that ain't coming from Kevin. Get to them, and it keep them focused, and it keep them strong. Nothing else. Mm. Nothing, there's nothing more, it's priceless to just see them walk in those words.
Now, you performed a lot with secular. Sometimes the only person, in a lot of cases, the only. When you're booked, you're being booked now, I sometimes notice, as just an artist. And you're on secular platforms, the biggest of them, and they won't. It's like nobody can walk around you, Kevin. And how do you feel about that? Being able to play to the secular,
my brother,
to be rubbing shoulder with dance solos.
Again, to God be the glory, because when an artist, when somebody be a secular artist would walk over, shake your hand and say, boss, your song, them bless me. That's big. Mm-hmm. That's big. Because we preach with this, but we preach with the lifestyle.
Do you get a pushback from Christendom?
Absolutely not.
You don't get what the turncoats, as we call them, got from gospel, because they were not trusted initially. I don't know what their status is right at the moment, but they were not trusted by Christendom. They were getting followed in some quarters. They were getting a pushback for, they didn't trust them as real Christians. Mm-hmm. Do you get any of that, given the fact that you're performing in the secular space?
Not really. For one of the things I try to keep around me is solid mentors. Mm-hmm. You will get a message from somebody now and then to say, why are you putting this song on an EDM? Stuff like that.
Yes.
Stop. No one, like Goodbye World now, we're having this video. And why are you moving that song and put it on a rhythm like that, toom, toom, with so much beat on the bass? But that's just the few. I've learned to not focus on the few.
Good.
And I've learned to put solid pillars around me, mentors, who I'd be able to call and say, what do you think? Men who have great ears, who walk path, walk up journey, that may not reach it. Who's able to say?
Men with wisdom.
Yes. Who's able to say, Kevin, I've been there before. Relax and focus.
All right, so took a little bit now about your growing up in all of four parishes.
Gee.
Born in Westmoreland.
But,
yes, explain that for us.
I was born in Westmoreland. Some of Jamaicans know my story, but being born to a 14-year-old mommy. 14-year-old.
Oh.
I don't have to go into the details of what that struggle was, but it was tough. Born in Westmoreland, came up to Hillshire after a while, moved to Maxfield Avenue. From Maxfield Avenue, I think I moved about four times on Maxfield Avenue. Mm-hmm. Let me call out the road.
Starting
and
at
know
what
me
age?
At dark,
what age did you?
That was like,
what age were you when you went there first?
That was like 10, 11, 12, 13, 14.
Right up, okay.
Freeman Lane. Mm-hmm. Big up. Pretoria Road. Mm-hmm. Nelson Road. Maxfield Avenue. So we used to walk across Trenchtown every day. Trenchtown. Tank. That was I call home. With the tear pants, but no shoes.
Up to when?
14, 15, 16 years old.
Up to 16. So you spent
most of my teenage life living in the inner city.
Okay.
And I never call it ghetto. Ghetto is always here. It's how you approach it.
Yes.
And I went to Melrose All Age. Yes, Melrose All Age. From Melrose, I went to Jose Marti. Jose Marti to Camperdown. Camperdown to 1 year at Exed, and then UA.
For your music, where would you? To which of these places that you've grown up in,
mm-hmm.
would you attribute most of the influence?
Boy, I must say, Westmoreland, my early years, when I watched my mother struggle with a little flour in her hand, just enough to make one little dumpling, put the plate in front of me, cut it in a four, and I could never eat half that dumpling. I would eat half of that dumpling and pass the plate over to her. My mom told me that, because I couldn't remember that. And when she would sit and tell me that story of how there would be no food in the house, and me as a baby would walk across in the cane piece, and I was fat, you know. So when I leaned upon a cane, it broke.
So she was feeding you well. She was a teenager, but she was making sure that you're cared for.
Mom,
is it?
You're my hero. you are my hero. Daddy, big up to yourself. But mommy, hero. So it's those days, and then Maxfield Avenue, where you grew up around everything, my brother, everything. Gun, coke, everything, weed, everything. And you had a choice. It was there. Mommy, I know you're watching this, but I've gone before. Mm-hmm. Challenge to just do it. And I've said, respect you, no, school.
You made that call.
Gone. Boss it. I say, out of respect, my brethren. My heart not dead or something.
Where did you get that resolve, that strength, the strength to do that? Where? I mean, I know
you asked the question and I'm asking the same question too.
Yes.
I have absolutely no other name to say that's it but God. I mean, He was there when I didn't even know myself, when I didn't even know why may I do this, why would I do this, why would I stand up? When the brethren said I got on the road, go do this, I would say, sir, I'm going to my yard, I go, nothing, there's nothing in the yard to do. I'm not going to take up my book, but I'm going home. I don't know what I'm going to do. Whole road empty because all the man them gone on the road, but I'm here, I'm good. Big up to Mark on Maxfield Avenue, because it was like, when I lived on Maxfield, Mark was Miss Patsy, blessings. That's his mother. It was two of us who push each other. You see, when there's nothing like having a companion when you're going through tough times. Mm-hmm. One, just one person you want to help you stand up. When the strata bus with upon my face, I study the same way, study for exam. You get this, all right, you're good. Just one person. Sometimes these guys going through in the inner city, sometimes they just want one more person to believe in them. And me and Mark was like this. We pushed each other. I passed, and he's now a good, successful fireman. I've been there. I've been held up, coming in late, Virgin said, yo, where you come from? I said, boss, yeah, come home. Oh, yeah. Okay. Going in on my side, you know. I can feel the cold steel pressing against you. And then so many other areas where I could have been, I was caught in a shootout. And so many people were just at the wrong place at the wrong time. I can never get up and say, I'm gonna pop my collar. And just, yeah, I'm the boss, yo, you know? I'm nowhere yet. There's always somebody need to know that, yo, you're in the zinc fence, community, all that's around the zinc fence, but the zinc fence don't define you. Yeah. You can rise bigger, you can become the doctor who you want to become. You can become the liar who you want to become. The gun does not define you. And the community that you come from does not define you. You can step out of that.
Ultimately, where are you heading career-wise?
My focus, my brother, for now and for the next 10, 15, 20 years, is to impact this generation in the deepest way possible. And if you notice, if you hear what I talk, which means it might not just be music.
Okay.
My whole ministry might branch to many different areas because everybody listens to music. Somebody might read a book. As a matter of fact, I'm an author. I wrote my first book in 2015.
Yes, we should have asked you about that, yes.
So we're trying to find many different platforms.
And what is the book about?
It is the background behind my second album.
Okay.
The stories and my experience and so on. Mm. So you ask me. My focus is to hear what God say and just follow through.
Follow through. So that means he can take you anywhere?
Anywhere.
And there is a new project coming out.
Yes.
A video project.
Goodbye World.
Goodbye World. That's the title of the song.
Goodbye World. Hashtag. Anything you do on Instagram or Twitter, hashtag it for me. Goodbye World. May 16th, it's gonna drop. It's gonna be
okay.
Big. World, I know, on stages all across the world. So once you go to my YouTube, I'm gonna make sure Winford have it. But from his page to my page, Kevin Downswell, YouTube, Instagram, Kevin Downswell, Twitter, Kevin Downswell, Facebook, Kevin Downswell Ministry, it will be all there. Goodbye World, video drops. And that's track number one on the new album.
All right, so let's give them a bit of it.
Let's do this.
Goodbye World. Pleasure. Stay no longer. Well, if you know what I want, let me see everybody hands go up, up, up. Let me see you wave it in the air. I'm waving like you have no fear. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life.
Were you the only one for that 14-year-old?
No, I have two younger brothers and a younger sister. Latoya, that's my baby sister. I still call you baby. Yes, you're my baby. Even though you're 17 years old, you're still my baby sister.
Okay.
And my youngest brother, who is 30, and my other brother, Orin, and my other brother, Brian. Mm-hmm. So I'm brothers and I have a sister.
Everybody jump, jump, jump!
Kevin! Thank you so much, sir, for coming and sharing right here on stage with us and ministering to us and inspiring us. And so there you have it. Kevin Downswell, a story of great inspiration. Winfred Widdows, on behalf of all of us, thanking you for joining us. Do join us again next week for more on stage.
To big up the sun. Well, if you know what I want, let me see everybody hands go up, up, up. Let me see wave it in the air. I'm waving like you have no fear. I made up my mind to go God's will the rest of my life.
Thanks for watching our video. If you're not yet a subscriber, click now and be on stage. Always.